Hi, it's Larry Hryb, Xbox's Major Nelson. Welcome to 2023. Welcome to the official Xbox podcast. The whole gang is here. We got Jeff over there on the left. Hi, Jeff.
Hi, we're in a gang.
Happy New Year, Jeffrey, and Rebecca over there on the right. Now, Rebecca, you are back. You were kind of traveling for a few weeks. You were moving. Of course, you joined us for the live show, but you're back.
Yeah, it's been a stressful month and a half. I've been ping-ponging around the West Coast a lot, but I'm finally home in the Bay. I had a really good time in Seattle, but I'm finally home and settled, and it's good to be back.
And you know what makes it home? Yes. That little guy behind you. Oh,
I know.
He's so little.
I know. Pumbaa is a California dog now, but he's still just as lazy as ever. He basically just sleeps there the whole time I'm working. But he's a very cute addition to my background for my on-camera calls.
Because when you were living in New York, unfortunately, he wasn't living with you. He lived with a little bit at the beginning, but then you sent him back home, right?
Yeah, he was not enjoying New York, and my parents love him, and they have a big backyard, so we sent him back to Seattle, and he had a good time, but he's definitely, it hasn't been sunny so much lately, but you might have heard we've got this like big storm going on in California right now, but overall, like, he doesn't like the rain, he doesn't like cold weather, so he's going to be very happy to live here, I think.
Well, welcome.
2 minutes, 35 seconds into the new year, weather has been brought up on the podcast. I know.
Wasn't me.
Yeah. It's fair. Hey, it's crazy weather in California right now, though.
No, it's so true. Stay safe. I've been hearing from friends. Yeah.
But anyway, it's great to have everybody back. Hopefully everybody had a good new year. I know that I was playing a lot of games. I finished High on Life, which was a lot of fun.
Oh.
Jeff, I don't even think you've started it, have you?
No, I have. I'm on the second level. My brother came by this weekend and he was like, "You haven't beaten this yet?" And he was very
into it. I know, I'm kind of surprised.
I was traveling for basically, we did our live show. True. I was on a plane less than
24 hours later.
You had an awesome holiday.
I did. So basically, I was traveling and it was like we would do whatever family stuff during the day. And then at night, sun sets very early, it's cold, whatever. Streamed Persona 5 just on my laptop, like for, you know, until 2 in the morning.
I saw you playing a lot.
And then wake up and do it again. I think I clocked about 50 hours on this vacation. So, but it was all while everyone, I was jet lagged anyway. I'm playing Persona. So good. I've literally had like the battle theme music in my head nonstop. Like I wake up and I'm hearing the music.
I feel bad. I should have had that queued up ready for you.
That's
your walk on music. Let me find it.
Oh, that would be amazing. Okay. All right. Well, we're doing it. But that's most of what I got to play. And then because I only had like my little work laptop, I was still able to play Vampire Survivors, which was great. Mm-hmm. So like on the flight, I had like whatever was on TV, you know, that's the only time I watched like HBO specials because they always have like episodes 2, 3, and 4 of the, whatever their most recent season is. They never put episode 1 in. Like why?
Yeah.
Why? Anyway. I had Vampire Survivors and I was like, okay, that's the next 10 hours of my life. And I wasn't complaining.
Speaking of Vampire Survivors, have you played it yet, Rebecca? Because I know that on the live show you were talking about it and Jeff and I had spent the past 3+ weeks talking about it. Have you had a chance to play it yet?
No, you guys did talk about it a lot. Sorry. I've been playing High on Life.
Like,
wow. As if he hasn't heard it enough.
Like, now you hear what I hear. This is what I hear all day long, 24 hours a day in my head. This is where I go for my all-out attack right about here.
Okay.
You're going to finish him.
Enough. Anyway.
Great job, Panther.
Okay, sorry, Rebecca. I'll save that, Jeff, so I can pull that up on cue much more quickly next time.
There we go. Next time.
Yes. Then we'll do the boss music. See. Okay.
We're talking about Vampire Survivors.
Yes. Sorry. No, I haven't played that one, but I should give it a shot. Do you guys think I would like it?
Yes.
Okay.
I think it's like, I think it's an entirely new genre. Like I remember when like roguelikes first started.
What would you call it?
Oh, this is, that's a really good question. But like because I guess it was like Rogue Legacy. I mean, it's literally like named after, that's why it's like Rogue. That was like, okay, this is interesting. But now there are so many of those types of games. And we look at like where it can go, like Hades, or just think of like a battle royale where it, you know, it started with I don't know if it was PUBG is the first one that I knew. And then it just like has gone from there. And it's just like, it's so well established. I feel like Vampire Survivors is that type of thing, 'cause it's such a stripped down thing. And yet I want to see what other people do. Other people build on this type of, limited combat, but where you're just like sort of evading and seeing how long you can survive and what kind of twists can happen on that. That's why I think it's resonated so well with people, despite being like 8 or 16-bit type of graphics. Obviously, the amount of things on screen or something that your Sega Genesis could have done. It's just, it gets into your head. And anyway, you just need the cat talking. Anyway, you got to play.
It's pretty catchy.
It is. And it's just like, if you're going to listen to a track for like 100 hours, it better be. But somehow you don't get sick of that. I think Larry is very into this, by the way.
Well, it's interesting because most of the JRPGs have wailing guitar, and I haven't heard the wailing guitar yet.
Yeah,
there's other tracks. Some of the dungeon I'm in now has got some pretty wailing guitar. Now, if you get to this part of the song, you're not doing very well. Like, you should have worked the floor with them by that point. Like, if they, you know, you got put to sleep or something like that. Anyway, we'll stop there. You were playing me off. Like, I was, like, I had won a game award, yeah, exactly. And I just wouldn't shut up.
Thank you very much. Anyway, so Rebecca, what have you been playing over the holiday? We talked about, you know, I finished High on Life, and that was such a fun ride. That was a fun single player game to play on Game Pass, play over the holidays. What have you, I know you've been moving, but have you had a chance to play?
Yeah. Yeah. So when I've been in Seattle, I've been playing a lot of Marvel Snap, like,
right, kind which of you showed up, which you showed amount. Last time on the show.
Yeah, I got a new phone for Christmas, and so it just like works better and the battery lasts longer. And so I've been like sitting here and like playing the game. It was even to the point where my mom was like, you know, we're trying to have dinner and like sitting and talking together. And she put down the phone, and I was like, okay. So I still am really enjoying Marvel Snap. And then I've also been playing High on Life when I've been back here in the Bay. So
how many of the weapons do you have?
Just, well, does the knife count?
I guess so.
I just got, I think, Gus, the second gun. So I'm on to the third bounty mission. I have to say, I'm really enjoying how kind of simple High on Life is. Like, you know, I don't have to do a lot of work scavenging for resources or like, you know, figuring out how to customize my gun aside from just going to the pawn shop and picking up pieces. And, you know, I get a mission to go kill a bounty hunter.
And that's what you're doing.
I do it, and then I come back and I'm like, you know what? I kind of miss this.
Yeah, it's kind of a straightforward, simplistic approach, right?
Right. I really enjoy it. It doesn't feel, you know, it still feels like a, you know, AAA game in that, you know, the quality and of course the guns and the just like humor and the dialogue is really funny. Like, I think I saw that people were talking about how you can kill a child in High on Life. Like, you can kill that really annoying kid, which I also did. And then I got the achievement for it.
Yes, get the achievement if you don't.
Get out of my way.
If you do, you have to.
Yeah.
Well, then you go and you talk to the mom. Right. And the mom was like, I understand. Thanks. In fact, thank you. Yes.
I know. I was like, I was laughing out loud for that part. I was like, I can't believe that. And then, this by the way,
that's like in the first hour plus of the game, right? It's right off the bat.
Yeah. It was just, I was like, whew, this, I was not expecting this. So, it's been, the achievement's
very funny too, as I recall.
Yeah.
How much of Tammy and the T-Rex did you end up watching?
Ugh, I think I've watched it all the way through.
I need to do that. I haven't done that.
I mean, it's only like a 3-minute clip or something, right? Like, it's kind of short.
No.
Isn't it?
It's the whole movie.
It's a major
movie.
Motion picture.
I thought that it was because it's always just, maybe I need to sit there longer and watch it.
I think he said there's like 4 different movies.
Right.
Like, when you go back, then what's his name's watching something else. And then as
the story progresses, Gus is watching a bunch of different things. So,
okay. I need to just stare at the TV on my TV
Does he remind you, I don't know about you, Jeff or Rebecca, does he remind you of like, you know, one of your old uncles sitting on the couch?
Yes,
basically.
Very much so. Ah, see.
Yes. Yeah. I'm surprised he's not sleeping one of the times you come home, right?
Right.
Like, he's always awake or like not eating anything either. Like,
stay tuned.
Yeah.
Anyway, well, I'm glad you're enjoying that. And again, it's available, High on Life, available. If you're a little bit behind, you're just checking the podcast out. Now go back and listen to the interview I did with Justin a couple weeks ago. Scroll back on your device. It's a couple of shows back. Actually, I think it may be the previous show. I don't know. And because he really talks about the game design and what he is, his vision is, and Game Pass. It was a really fun interview.
Awesome.
Jeff?
I agree. Yeah. There's nothing more to add to that. No, it's really cool. I think you should do more of those, like sort of the long form interview with some of the, you know, the interesting people we get to work with or who are producing
which
really
we interview
cool stuff.
Yeah, that's fair.
But we try to jam it into like 10 minutes to fit into the show. But I think it was really cool to like stretch that out, put a clip in the show, but then put out the interview, separate it for people that really want to have that deep dive. I think that is
I think I'll do that. I'll find maybe for some interviews coming up, I'll find the opportunity to do that and we'll figure it out. But we're just going to experiment and try new things and see what people like, see what sticks, as they say.
Is that what they say?
They say.
Okay.
We got some news.
That's what they say.
Actually, you know what? Before we get into the news, Jeff and Rebecca, I wanted to talk a little. I hear you guys. I want to talk a little bit about, and I've got my notes up here, about what we're waiting for. Because here we are. We're at the front door of 2023. We just opened the door. We're just walking through. What are you guys looking forward to? I mean, this what we know about games that are released right now that have been announced. We're not going to give any release and unreleased information now. This is all out there. But we got a lot of games coming. Jeff, I know you've got a list in front of you, right? That you're interested in.
I was just looking at a post and it's all the games that have dates that have, you know, for this calendar year. And it's mostly in the first 6 months. And just that, it just looks
Can you kind of rattle
incredible.
Some of them off for us?
Sure. Well, Persona 4 Golden and it's going to be coming out in just a couple of weeks, coming to Game Pass.
Do I need to bring it up again?
You should. No, it's different. They have different songs. It's completely different in that one. Something actually I was just thinking about is Age of Empires 2 is coming to console really soon.
Yeah.
And that's something that, we're starting to work
they
on.
They announced
and
that on
I
the
got
Age
to
of Empires
test that out.
25th
anniversary. Yeah, back in like September, October. So I'm just looking at this list. The Dead Space remake, I've been hearing really good things. I was listening to What's Good Games over the break, and they were looking forward to like their games and their favorite games or most looked forward to games of the year. And so they're remaking that game, and Isaac Talks Now and making it more modern is something really cool. I will say something, and this is not going to surprise anyone, but February 21st, I may just call in sick
because
Like a Dragon Isshin is coming out.
And oh my, is that a Yakuza game?
Well, now they're calling them like a dragon. And,
are they trying to distance themselves from the criminal organization? The alleged criminal organization?
Hardly. I think that the name it was like RGG, it stands for something that I cannot pronounce and I don't want to butcher the Japanese, but, that meant Like a Dragon. I think it was just in the West, it was referred to as Yakuza. So now it's going consistently with that name, Like a Dragon. Anyway, Isshin was announced when they had all of their announcements last year. It's the first one to come out and it takes place. It's a remake of one that takes place in like late 1800s Japan. So that just looks really cool.
Feudal?
And I don't know if that was the feudal era. I don't know if that was like the Meiji Restoration. I'd really have to look it up. Okay. And I'm sure
don't hold us
it,
to that,
it fits
folks.
In there. But it was a period of time where Japan had briefly opened up to the West. And so, things were changing pretty rapidly. And anyway, it seems like a really interesting period of time to explore. And of course, what they did is they took all the main characters from like the Yakuza series and put them into inhabiting different characters, but from that era. So as if they existed back
then.
That's
pretty cool. I like that.
I think so.
Would you call that
continuing down the list?
I don't know if that's a mashup per se.
Sometimes you would have like episodes of shows where like, what if they went back in time and they were playing different roles like that, or like a Simpsons Treehouse of Horror. It's almost kind of like that, where they're just, so you see familiar faces, but they're not necessarily the same people, or are they? I don't even know.
Right.
But that's why I'm going to play it February 21st.
Yeah, it sounds cool.
Star Wars Jedi Survivor, March 17th. So that's kind of, I mean, that's looking very good from the things that we've seen. Actually, March in general, Woe Long Fallen Destiny starts off the month. Then Resident Evil 4 towards the end of the month, March 24th. That remake looks just phenomenal. And I know I'm going to be all over that. Dead Island 2 is going to be finally coming out. And that's in April.
We had a friend that used to work on that podcast, series. Is he still working on that series?
He's no longer working there. Okay. That was a long time ago.
Yeah,
he launched the first one. Yeah, quite a bit. Legend of Zelda, Tears of the Kingdom. Like, we're fans of games. That's coming out in May. Street Fighter 6, Diablo 4, I mean, in June. I mean, there's so many things. And of course, I'm just mentioning things that have a set release date where there's literally a calendar date. I can't wait to play Redfall. That's one that I'm just like super hyped for.
Yeah.
And we have, you know, many other things I know we'll be talking about this year. So not even remotely close to an exhaustive list, but those are some of the things that are really jumping out at me for the next 6 months that I'm just so ecstatic to play.
Yeah. I mean, I remember you and I and Rebecca, we were all talking last year about how, we got great games in 2022, but 2023 and now we're here, and to hear Jeff, you just said just this list, which is a great list, but I'm sure there's even more. There's always surprises.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah. Not even remotely. Go on.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to hearing more about Starfield at some point.
Yeah.
And then also, Jeff mentioned Redfall. I think that one looks really cool. I definitely want to try it out. It feels like a really good multiplayer game. So
I'm actually really excited about that because it takes place in a fictitious New England island. And I spent a lot of time.
Oh yeah.
I grew up in New England and I spent a lot of time on different islands. So I'm interested to see what they've connected and what the essence, because even just from the gameplay I've seen, I'm like, yep, that's it. So.
Well, previous Arcane games, like when we think, of Dishonored, we think of Prey, they didn't take place in like kind of like more real world situations. Right. It was either,
they're Prey, more fantasy,
spacefaring,
and fantasy spinoff.
Exactly. Yeah. So they'll have the opportunity to sort of, skewer or their take on New England, as you say, and that could be really interesting. I'm curious to see what they say.
I mean, if there's not a Dunkin' Donuts in there, or as fans of this show remember, coffee milk.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Coffee milk.
You didn't listen to the show when you were gone, did you?
No.
You missed out on a lot.
We'll talk about that out there.
So. Let's see. A couple others, too. I saw some footage from Hogwarts Legacy. And, surprisingly, I grew up in the,
Harry Potter era.
But I don't think I've ever played a Harry Potter video game. But it actually looks really cool. I saw some good footage of them, doing... what's it called? Is it horde mode where you get the waves of varying difficulties?
Yeah, we can call it horde mode.
Yeah, I saw some kind of horde mode footage where, you're using a wand and you're casting spells and you're fighting against the dwarves, the guys who guard Gringotts. And then, there's different Death Eaters that come in and you're kind of fighting them. And so it looks pretty cool. And then the other one I was curious about is if you guys are looking forward to Assassin's Creed Mirage. I only played a little bit of the Assassin's Creed games. It was a long time ago, but Mirage looks really cool. It's a very cool setting.
It looks like it's so the last three Assassin's Creeds, of which I've played them all the way through.
15 Origins, years Assassin's Creed's been around.
Yeah, it was 2007. So this will be 16. They became sort of really sprawling open world RPGs, which is great. Had a tremendous amount of fun. I played each one of the last three for over 100 hours each. But the original several of Assassin's Creed games were more focused literally on assassination and finding your way in and sneaking and less about sort of leveling up and things like that. Now, it does seem like Mirage is more focused on sort of that core original Assassin's Creed experience. And so it'll be interesting to go back to that, but through a more modern lens, like you said, it's not going to play like AC1 in 2007. It's going to play like a modern game. So really curious to see that. And of course, they're still going to be those sprawling RPG type assassins as well. So they're really, why not both?
Yeah, I'm looking at the description here and people are calling it's going to be a smaller and more, quote, traditional Assassin's Creed game. So it's interesting to see how Mirage is just going to get kind of go back to its roots and see, because what we've noticed is anybody that's been playing games for as long as all of us have, and I'm sure many of the listeners and viewers, is you can see the evolution of gameplay in terms of over the years. Courtney, you know, 10 years ago, Battle Royale wasn't a thing. Now it is. So it's interesting to see how the open world, I don't want to say they're not going to close the world off. I don't think that's fair. I think to your point, Jeff, they're just going to go back to the basics.
More focused.
Of what the game was about.
Yeah. Definitely a good call out.
So anyway, so that's kind of what we're waiting for in 2023. Jeff, we got some news to kind of click off here. I don't know if you've got your news.
Sure.
Let's open up the news. I don't have any news desk music.
But well, it is a relatively, look, the first week in January, generally one of the slowest weeks of the year. But we did have a stealth drop of a game that I think, Larry, it might be really up your alley, which is Stranded Deep.
Yep.
So this is in the aftermath of a mysterious plane crash, you are stranded in the Pacific Ocean, and alone or with a friend, you do what you can to survive. You build things, you craft. You look at the image and it's like there's sharks in the water and you're like surviving the elements. And, you know, could you survive in that sort of Lost-esque
little castaway action experience. It feels.
Yeah, Castaway probably a little more right on. So it definitely seems like something you might be into with, like, you know, the diving. I see the picture of like the person like fighting and there's the shark.
I don't fight
that
sharks.
Just scares the hell out of me.
I won't
go into the water for that reason.
I just don't like open water. Rebecca, I don't remember. Are you a scuba diver? I know Jeff is not.
I've gone scuba diving a couple times.
Have you ever gone diving and encountered sharks?
No, that is a huge nightmare.
I have done that, and it is it's a horrifying experience because Jeff, to your point, I love underwater and I love underwater animals and sea life. Mm-hmm. Anyway, I remember seeing the shark for the first time, and I was like, "Oh, this is really cool, a shark!" And then this complete wave of panic came over because I realized there's no glass between us. I'm not in an aquarium. I am in its element, and I am now on its terms to whatever it wants to do. And it was. The sea may have been yellow that day, my friend.
Yeah. I don't even like dealing with the sharks in like Sea of Thieves. Like, really? Even that is like, I just don't.
Stressful. Yes.
I don't like being in the water, like in real life, in games, anything. But
anyway,
this is your thing.
Looking forward to that.
It's on Game Pass. No, it's there now. So, you know, get after it. Also, it's CES this week. And
Consumer Electronics Show. I haven't been in years.
And you haven't been in years because CES has not really been a gaming show in a really long time. Probably at least a decade, probably, since you really would see like major gaming announcement. There was a time when it was a really big gaming show. What it is now that gets me excited is, what am I going to be playing these games on? And so we have actually a breakdown on Microsoft.com. There's a CES page about all these gaming PCs. We're actually going to have a post on, well, by the time you hear this, a post on Wire as well.
Yep.
Of what Asus and Acer and Razer and all of these different manufacturers are putting together. And basically the NVIDIA 40 series RTX are coming out now. And I think starting next month, you'll be able to start getting laptops with a 4,000 level, you know, 40, 60, boom, 70, 80, you name it, GPU in there. I mean, and that's just amazing to me, like what you're able to do, how powerful these are, and being able to take that on the road. I have like severe like gaming PC envy now because the
FOMO.
PC I'm on right now, it's great, it's powerful, plays just about everything. It's a 2080 Super. This thing is two generations old now. There's going to be laptops out there next month that could blow it away. And
I have, while you, over the holiday, I got a couple of new gaming PCs.
A couple?
Oh, really?
What are you just collecting?
I know, right?
Collect all five?
Well, you know, when you don't know whether you're going to go Christmas Intel presents and AMD, you go both. So if you don't know if you're going to go, you know, Radeon or NVIDIA, you go both. So anyway, I've been dabbling in that.
Do you? Okay. All right. So you just got them? You just went for it?
Anyway, so
I'll, are you just testing them out?
I'll talk about those on a future show. I don't want to plug up your news section.
No, no. So that's the main thing, you know. So really, just seeing that Razer announced a handheld that is,
yeah, I'll have hands on with that in the coming weeks.
Okay.
The one that they had reserved for me is actually at CES right now. They're using it for demos.
Oh, funny.
So they're gonna get one for me. So stay tuned on that.
So we've seen some like handheld streaming devices that are, yep, are built on I believe like the Android architecture. And where you could stream games from, you know, like Game Pass through Xbox Cloud Gaming. This one has 5G built into it, so you won't have to be tethered to Wi-Fi. And as someone, like I said, I was on the road and just like, even with really low bandwidth, this is a boss battle right here, Larry. This is where it gets tough, you know. I'm a true believer, and it was just awesome to like, just log on, see my friends list, and just be playing no matter where I was at. Even again, with like some pretty subpar, we're talking like 15 megs down, no problem.
It's interesting though, you actually texted me because you were at a few hotels as you were traveling. One of the hotels, the Wi-Fi did not play well with your gaming, right?
Well, one of them, I think they had set up a firewall, and I found this out when I was trying to watch a soccer match, and ended up, there are ways. And
there are ways.
Where there's a will, there's a way, usually.
Yes. I just had to think outside the box a bit. So yeah. So that's again, relatively slow week for news. Obviously it'll pick up as time goes by when you see all the games that are, you know, coming out, the ones we know about, the ones we may not. It'll be fun, but I'm kind of enjoying a bit of a slower week this week, and get to continue playing the games that are in my prodigious backlog.
Speaking of games, one of the games that's out is We Are the Caretakers, and I was able to get an interview with that. I don't know, Rebecca, if you can bring us into that interview. It was a fun time because I was able to catch up with an old friend.
Yeah, so Scott Brodie from We Are the Caretakers had a chat with Larry, and as a reminder, that game is out today. So let's check out the interview.
We Are the Caretakers is now available on Xbox. Very excited to have that game on the platform. Joining me today is Scott Brodie, who not only is he, you know, behind the game, but also Scott, you and I used to work together, right?
That's right. Thanks for having me on. Yeah, we used to work together quite some time ago. I think it was almost 12 years ago. I used to be on the Xbox Live Arcade producer team. And so I worked on a ton of indie games there, as well as an original title called Aegis Wing, if many of you know about that. Yeah.
Tell us about it, because it was, I mean, it's interesting because you were at the beginning of the dawn of Xbox Live Arcade. And as we look in the rearview mirror 10, 12 plus years ago, it was so new then. I remember, you know, some people had to get a disc because they didn't have the bits installed, but you started digitally delivering games. Certainly Steam had done it for a few years, but this is one of the first times the consoles had done it, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it was one of the reasons I wanted to come to Microsoft was I was just passionate about getting these, you know, casual games and then indie games, you know, on a console, which was a new concept, you know, back then. And so it was really fun to be a part of that kind of genesis of getting smaller, but, you know, diverse, different types of gameplay on the console, and got to work with a lot of really cool people along the way. And I think it's had a nice little mark on Xbox, you know, long term, about the types of content that can be on the platform and the types of games that got made.
Yeah. And then, of course, now you have your own studio, Heart-Shaped Games. You guys are based in Ann Arbor, Michigan, here in the United States. Tell us a little bit about your history after you left Xbox and your journey to Heart-Shaped Games.
Yeah. So honestly, I, you know, from my work at Microsoft, I kind of just got the itch to do it myself, just talking with all these indie developers and having a background in development. So I started small with a couple of games where we were working with two to three people, but, you know, fast forward to now, and We Are the Caretakers has been a 4.5 year development cycle. And we've had a team of as big as 12 people working on it. So it's been kind of a great journey to kind of build a company and build to a point where I could make something a little bit more substantial.
So We Are the Caretakers is out now today as the podcast is being posted. Tell us a little bit, what is the game about? I've got some B-roll here, so I'm going to go ahead and roll that. But talk us through a little bit about what we can expect with the game.
Yeah, absolutely. So I've been calling it a grand strategy JRPG, and it's kind of a mix of a whole bunch of different genres and ideas, but the idea is that you are the Caretakers, which is this faction trying to protect their civilization from poachers and outside forces trying to take down their society, as well as these giant fictional but endangered creatures in this world. And so as you can kind of see in the B-roll here, you have this headquarters where you can organize hundreds of characters into different squads. So it's a JRPG, but instead of having just a single party, you actually can have up to 9, and you can deploy them out onto the field to try to find enemies, poachers, animals, etc. And then once two of these kind of groups get together, so one of your teams and one of the poacher teams get together, it goes into a turn-based combat system that is pretty fun. So it's a blend of a lot of ideas, but it's based around this idea of protecting animals, and is really inspired by kind of real-world animal conservation as well. But we took it far and added aliens and a sci-fi theme to make it exciting. But fundamentally, at its core, there's a real world kind of inspiration there.
And it's interesting you talk about the animal conservation, because there's actually, you know, you do that's what in the game itself, but you actually translated that in the real world, because you're actually doing some you're making some donations to the conservation work from the title. Is that accurate?
Yeah. So we actually had a chance to meet some of the, you know, rangers and scientists in the field to kind of do research for the game. But we were really inspired by the work they did and saw the need that they had. And so we wanted to try to do our part. And so we're giving 10% of net revenue to Wildlife Conservation Network. And they have a specific program, the Rhino Recovery Fund, which is about protecting rhinos, which is kind of our fictional animal is kind of loosely based off of a rhino in the game. So we felt passionate about that cause, and we're happy to, you know, have made this cool game that could both bring awareness to what's going on, as well as, you know, real world impact with some funds, hopefully.
One of the things when we look at RPGs and JRPGs, and you and I kind of talked about this off the air, is like it's a genre that can be challenging for the controller. So tell us a little bit about what your team has done to and learnings, and what you looked out there that people are doing now that you're like, this is what we need to do. And we're seeing some of the turn-based here, right?
Yeah, so because we have these different strategic layers, we almost had to create 3 different controller implementations for the different types of game, and we definitely iterated on that a lot. In the turn-based portion of the game, you have your kind of traditional, you know, select your abilities, yep. And then choose your target interface, which works well enough. We also have an auto battle feature to it, which I think not only speeds up gameplay, but just makes it a little bit more user friendly for folks who really want to interact more with the narrative or just the high level strategic layers. But I think in terms of controls, where we spent the most time was in the RTS field. And I think we came up with a pretty good implementation where you kind of select anything that's at the center of the camera and are able to kind of interact there. And the other thing that we did was you can pause the game at any time. So you can actually pause and then give your commands while the game is paused. So it's not a twitchy RTS at all. It's really about this, you know, thinking about where we need to go and what to do, and not how fast you can do it. So I think those choices led to a kind of a good experience on the console.
With people that are, you know, you mentioned JRPGs, and of course Xbox has a history with JRPGs, and people, you know, there's a lot of people that really love them. How would you've been in the games industry, you worked here at Xbox, you're making your own, you know, people hear JRPG, and I love backing up a little bit and kind of saying, hey, and asking experts like yourself, what does that mean to somebody who keeps hearing that term and maybe knows what it means? It's a Japanese, how would you explain that style to somebody who's new to the genre?
Yeah, I mean, I think the distinction is obviously just, you know, inspired by the classic, yep. You know, Japanese RPGs from Squaresoft and those types of things. And we're definitely inspired by those games. But I think fundamentally that there is a narrative component throughout, as well as party building. And so I think our game focuses on that. We have a really amazing narrative written by Zalvir Nelson Jr., who has made a number of other Xbox games and is just, you know, won awards for narrative. So we really leaned into his skill set and let him kind of go wild with the story. And then our game is really about that, you know, character collection, upgrading, and party formation. And we've kind of taken that to the extreme with having hundreds of characters and multiple parties. And so I think that's at least the parts of JRPGs that we took inspiration from in our game.
Yeah, and you can see here, we're seeing a little bit of the battlefields in terms of your zoomed out and kind of some of the narrative and how you guys wrap the narrative around this kind of this zoomed out view and what you can do there and seeing the gameplay go. What would you give, can you give us a little bit of some get started tips here for folks that are just downloading and checking out the game?
Yeah, I think the first thing is just understand it is narrative driven. So be ready to, engage with the story, because I think you'll have a lot more fun when you try to think about the mystery at the core of the game of, who are these poachers? Who are these aliens? What do they care about the animals? And then I do think making sure to use that pause feature I talked about, because it could feel overwhelming at first to kind of look at the map. But when you pause and take your time and set your commands, I think you'll have more fun. And then lastly, just spend time inspecting the different characters, because there's 30 different job classes. And so thinking about how to outfit them and how to combine them in your parties is a lot of fun. And so making sure to engage with that, I think will make sure that you kind of get all of the fun that's to be had.
Yeah, it looks like a lot of fun. Of course, you can download it right now. We Are the Caretakers, available today as the podcast goes up. It's available on Steam and Xbox. Scott Brodie, former Xbox member of Team Xbox here, worked on Arcade. It's so great to see you again, and I wish you success in your games, and I'm looking forward to seeing what more Heart-Shaped Games has in store.
Thanks so much for having me on, Larry, and thank you for everything you do for the community. You're such a good ambassador for games and having small developers like myself on here. So just thanks so much.
Scott Brodie, We Are the Caretakers, available now. I was reading about it. It actually, a lot of good things were in this sentence. Okay. We Are the Caretakers is an Afrofuturist sci-fi squad management RPG, .. blending inspirations from Ogre Battle, XCOM, Darkest Dungeon, Black Panther, Northgard, and Northgard. That's a lot of good stuff.
Yeah, it's quite a stew, isn't it?
And you know what?
Or let's call it a hot pot, shall we?
I like a good stew. We could do that too. So yeah, a lot of exciting things there. So planning on checking that out during my rare downtime in between.
Well, now you don't have any. Now that World Cup's over, you have no soccer to scream at the TV about.
The Premier League started right back up immediately.
Fair.
So there's plenty. Yesterday at this
Arsenal,
time,
Arsenal, please wait until Jeff is in his seat before you score.
We got. Wow, you follow me on Twitter, Larry. Yeah, still 20 matches to go this season, so plenty more.
All right. What else you got over there, Jeff or Rebecca, before we wrap up and let folks go?
I don't know, just a few good shows to check out, too, that I watched over the holiday break. So Chainsaw Man came out in the last few months, I think. And at first, it didn't really grip me. I feel like there are a lot of kind of anime tropes that are present in the beginning. It's like, oh, it's a squad of four. There's one girl, there's one guy who's really quiet, etc. One guy who's really like thirsty for women. But it got really good as the show went on. And so I would definitely recommend checking it out. Me and the family also watched Oni, Tale of the Thunder God on Netflix, which was, I heard that it was folks from Pixar who left and formed their own animation studio. The animation's really good. The story is pretty simple, but I really like it. It's super cute. So, I don't know. Just a couple things for people to check out.
All right. That's good to know.
Oh, and White Lotus season 2. Very, very good.
This happened on the flight. They had White Lotus and it had started at episode 2.
I know. I was thinking about that.
I got to get to that anyway.
Yeah. Really teasing you there. At least do episode 1, 2, 3 or something.
Hey, internet, let us know in the YouTube comments. Why would they stop? Why would they not show episode 1? There has to be a licensing issue. I can't imagine.
It has to. I'm sure there's a mundane lawyer infused reason why they can't do it. It is what it is, but it was no less frustrating.
All right.
Yeah.
All right, gang. Well, we're going to wrap up here. Will you join us, Rep? Rebecca, will you join us next week?
Yeah, I'll see you guys same time, same place.
Well, more importantly, will Pumbaa join us next week?
He will definitely be there same time,
there he
same
is.
Place.
Okay. All right, Jeff, you'll be back with us. We got to, but as Jeff said, it's kind of quiet this week, but things are going to start ramping up with all the releases and so forth. So we're going to be getting at it, as they say.
They say it.
They say it.
We'll do it. That's what they say.
All right, gang. We'll see you guys next week. Thanks for downloading. Have a great, thanks for joining us. Happy 2023, and we'll see you next week. Bye-bye, everybody.